Good morning. Thanks for joining us on this fourth Sunday during the month of June in the year 2020. We are glad that you are a part of our virtual worship experience. Thank you guys for continuing to come back week after week to support what we do here at 6 Mile Zion Baptist Church. Clearly, we miss our family in the house, but thank God that we have the opportunity to worship together in this virtual setting. And so we appreciate you tuning in. Why don't you take a second and hit somebody up and let them know, hey, my church is online right now. Why don't you tune in? If you're on YouTube or Facebook, if you're watching on Periscope, if you're checking us out on our church's website, if you're listening on Uber conference call, we say thank you this morning. It's not too late for you to give, not too early for you to give, I'm sorry. And we're going to share this again later at the end of worship. But if you want to jump on and give right now, it'd be a blessing. You can give online at our church's website, smzbc.org. Go to the Give Online link. You can also go to Cash App, $SMZBC. You can go to Venmo, SMZBC, as well. If you're mailing in your check, do know that we need those contributions to keep on coming. Send your contribution to 6 Mile Zion Baptist Church, 14 West Duval Street. Now, I'm going to be preaching from the book of Amos this morning, but before I jump into it, why don't you take a second and check out our instruments of praise dancers here at 6 Mile Zion. I believe they're going to bless us. After they finish ministering, I'll be back with the word from God.
Yeah. said he was the plumber need, yeah. According to the riches and glory, yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh,
dancers blessed us this morning. We thank God for them and for their ministry and all of the ministries that are contributing even during this time of virtual church. We thank you, Instruments of Praise, this morning for being a blessing to us. I'm going to ask that you turn your attention real quickly to the book of Amos, the 6th chapter, verses 1 through 7. As I'm going to preach this morning from a sermon entitled Fighting the Disease of Complacency. Fighting the Disease of Complacency. I'm going to read this morning from the New International Version. Usually we read from the Message here, but today God led me to read from the New International Version. This is what God says: woe to you who are complacent in Zion, and to you who feel secure on Mount Samaria. You notable men of the foremost nation to whom the people of Israel come, go to Kelna and look at it. Go from there to the great Hamath, and then go to Gath and Philistia. Are you better off than your two kingdoms? Is there land larger than yours? You put off the day of disaster and bring near a reign of terror. You lie on beds ordained with ivory and lounge on your couches. You dine on choice lambs and fatted calf. You strum away on your harps like David and improvise on musical instruments. You drink wine by the bowlful and use the finest lotions, but you do not grieve over the ruin of Joseph. Therefore, you will be among the first to go into exile. Your feasting and your lounging will end. Again, today, I'm going to share from this sermon subject, Fighting the Disease of Complacency. My brothers and my sisters, this is the second prophetic announcement of Amos to the nation of Israel. Amos is attempting to prevent the nation of Israel from being trapped by the tranquilizing injection of spiritual carelessness and complacency. Both carelessness and complacency have tempted Israel to think themselves better than others because of where they are, because of what they have, which blurs their vision of themselves and of everything around them. And as a result, they ignore the suffering and poor that live among them every single day. Amos calls it by description being at ease in Zion. At ease suggests that they have become so content and so complacent that they literally are now not useful to God. They have forgotten that God has set them free to live as change agents for the expanding kingdom of God. Their spiritual and social complacency has injected them with a lethal dose of inflated self-perception. In addition, Amos is sharing God's mind with them because they have also unwisely started measuring life by ignoring necessary burdens. Burdens like the need to spend one's life chasing intimately after God, the need to make hurting people a high priority, and the need to resist the lulling temptation of progress and success. To press his prophetic announcement to the nation regarding how at ease or complacent Israel is. The prophet draws their attention to the sarcasm of a parallel existence. He wants them to think about it by looking at the cities that are surrounding them. In fact, here is the sarcasm Amos implies. Go visit these other cities. Listen, take the whole nation with you and go visit these cities. Take a good look at them and ask yourself, should we be thinking about ourselves with this sort of self-inflamed self-assurance? Is Amos's literal saying, get up off your pedestals and go take a look at these cities. Get up off of your high horses and go take a look at these cities and notice that compared to them, you really are not much. What makes you great is not settling in success. What makes you great is not carrying an overinflated perception of yourself. What makes you great is not ignoring the poor amongst you, those suffering amongst you. What makes you great, God says, is this: you having me, God, as a provider. What makes you great is you having me as a protector. What makes you great is you having me as a sustainer. You are to live your lives expanding my presence through you to other people. Now, I hope that you quickly attach to Amos's central point, his prophetic observation that he shares before he is going to share with them the terrible revelation. Israel, you are chilling in Zion. Israel, you are complacent. You are content. Israel, you are at ease in Zion. And because of it, you are so comfortable in Zion that it has made you arrogant. So comfortable that it has made you self-assured. So comfortable that it has made you insensitive to others. So comfortable that you have become overly relaxed regarding your spirituality, and as a result, you have invited upon yourselves both doom and destruction. Have you noticed, as you've looked at the pages of the Old Testament, that Israel's journey with God always includes these necessary intersections where God has to adjust the national mindset of God's people? God does things at varied and multiple intersections to bring Israel back to a centered place of humility, to challenge the nation against living with too much confidence. Now, hear me today, this day, my brothers and my sisters, that God wants them to be fully faith confident. God just doesn't want them to be confident in themselves. God wants them confident in God. And here, one of the ways that God is describing life when it is too shaded by overconfidence is when one lives at a certain level of comfort. One lives at a certain level of contentment. One lives at a certain level of ease while in Zion. That is, we stop pushing to become something bigger for God. There is no longer a sense of urgency to do something greater for God. No, there is no humility to see others as having value and worth. Careless about the gift of life given, or careless about how quick life can be taken from you. God is suggesting to them, Israel, God is suggesting to us, Six Mount Zion family and friends, that life is way too short for you to live in comfort with a spirit of contentment at ease while in Zion. Life is too much a gift for a person to show their appreciation for being gifted by God by returning to God a life of complacency or carelessness. Amos's warning to Israel, revealing their unholy ease feeling in Zion, is really, in my theological estimation, a call to learn how to find acceptance in the holy place of spiritual uneasiness. I want to suggest that there is value in God keeping every one of us in a place that helps us to avoid becoming complacent. There is value in God never allowing us to see ourselves as having arrived. There is value in God making sure that we never get to a toxic, poisonous, or infectious place where we start seeing ourselves as better than everyone else around us, and it causes us to forget how quick things can change. Perhaps we should look today at the pockets in our lives where we grow weary about how short the time of ease has lasted. And before we critique too harshly God's inability to sustain the success in our lives or to stretch out the surpluses in our lives, I want to suggest this morning that we consider the varied ways of God showing us how God is good to us. One of the ways that God shows us how good God is to us is by what God gives us. One of the ways that God shows us how good God is to us is how God protects us. One of the ways that God shows us how good God is to us is by how God prevents stuff from getting to us. One of the ways that God demonstrates God's love for us is by what God promotes for us. One of the ways that God displays God's goodness to us is by God not stirring up things that God has gotten to calm and settle. God will make us have to jump an unwanted hurdle or walk through an unexpected dark valley. God will make us have to deal with some pain we thought had subsided. God will make us have to revisit a thought that we thought we had placed in history. God would have us to face a challenge that we did not want to face. And why does God do it? Because God wants situations agitated so that God can move us to the next level of our spiritual growth. God will make us uneasy. Not uneasy as a result of mismanagement or oversight or irresponsibility that has to stabilize the foundation of our lives. When these things happen, they make us nervous because we are standing on shaky ground. Amos is telling us, y'all, that the uneasiness that God allows or orchestrates or manipulates or manufactures is God sending, allowing, releasing what pushes us from a comfort zone that can be dangerous. It challenges me to have strength in the place right after reaching what I thought was my limit. And God makes me see what I was determined to ignore. I want to offer this morning that God wants every last one of us in here to learn how to live in a place relegated to the antithesis of comfort, relegated to the antithesis of a careless spirit. Sometimes God wants to poke us and prod us and push us and agitate us and stir us up. And God wants to instigate some stuff. Hear me, because that's the only way for us to see our next opportunity. I don't know if that makes sense in the time that we're living in right now, but maybe God is allowing for this stuff to happen. Maybe God is stirring some stuff up and agitating some things and messing some things up and causing some confusion and some things so that we can stop listening to those around us who are telling us that we've paid the price at this time and it's time for us to sit down. And just because they want to build a tent, it doesn't mean that God does not want you to have your vision cast further. There are a whole lot of folk caught in now while God is trying to stimulate us to next. God is trying to take us somewhere where we are stuck, or when we are stuck where we are. If all there is to life is what God has already shown us, then God may not be as big and as great as we thought, because we believe that God wakes us up every day to show us something greater about who God is and to push us to become something bigger in our lives. And I want to tell you that this ought to be your testimony, that God, I was settling, but I'm not going to settle anymore. I was satisfied, but I can't be satisfied in this present season. I need you, God, to agitate and to stir. There are some things that are in flux that I cannot explain. I'm not comfortable. I'm not laying in the cut or by the poolside or sticking my feet in the sand. This is a season of agitation.
But instead of getting depressed, I'm trying to teach us today to shout, because it is a gift from God to move us to a next level. And I'm telling you, yes, we're in a season of some chaos. Yes, we're in a season of some confusion. Yes, we're in a season of some movement. Yes, we're in a season of some things not being like they were yesterday. But out of it all, the world is going to be a better place. And I'm telling you, this is what Amos is trying to release to us today, a word that we need to hear, that we've got to learn to trust God when the season is the antithesis of comfort. Learn to trust God when the season is the antithesis of complacency. Learn to thank God for the gift of it not being as easy as we want it to be. Make the fact that God keeps pushing us further and harder and longer, make that a new normal. Stop treating these moments as the abnormal moments, and start seeing the abnormal as a time when nothing is staring. Now, this calls for this thought. We should never really allow ourselves to think that we've fully arrived. If we're going to fight this disease of complacency, we've got to get out of a spirit of thinking that we've fully arrived, that there is nothing to feel called to, nothing to be burdened by, nothing to be convicted of. The uneasiness has to become a norm. Why? Because it's in the pain and the staring and the agitation and the confusion that birthing is starting to take place. It becomes the working station, listen, for new ideas. It becomes the boardroom, God help me, for the development of new strategies and new models. It becomes the altar where faith now becomes stretched and spirituality becomes increased. It becomes worship where God lifts you to a higher place to show you something different. It becomes the place where who would have thought at the beginning of the year that you would be able to break out into a praise in your living room, or in your kitchen, or in your house, in your bedroom, because God is trying to break something in us. And it's not about where, but it's about how. It's about why. It's about what God is trying to do. And it's in this season of uneasiness, this season of complacency, this season of not being content, this season of not easy, that God will allow things to be attached to our lives because of what God wants to show us, where God wants to take us, and how much God wants to do in my life. With as gifted as I am, we will never settle to know but for so long. The more gifted you are, the more settled your life is going to be. It's going to be a boat ride. It's not going to be a boat ride over here and back. It's not going to be just running to Macedonia and coming back, shaking off some vapors over there, standing in front of, say, antagonists just alone, having to run from adversaries, having to declare a hard work to a hard people about a hard time in a hard season. The more gifted you are, and I know that I'm preaching to some gifted folk today. It seems like every time God shows you your gift, God agitates your life, and there's something about your life that's always in flux because God is trying to grow you. Now, here's a question this morning. Do you want to trade your gifts in order to settle your life down? God forbid, I'd rather have the agitation. Put me on a boat, God. Stand me in front of Pharaoh, God. I'll climb the mountain. I'll scale the valley. I'll shake the vapor. I will keep preaching. I'll keep on waking up every day, determined to stir up the gift that is inside of me. Why? Because I would rather have the gift and be agitated than absent the gift where my life is settled. So I'm convinced that most of us need to learn how to live in a state, in a space of spiritual uneasiness. Most of us need to learn how to fight the disease that has kept us complacent. I don't know who I'm talking to today. Wherever you are, you wake up every Sunday trying to tune in, trying to listen. You have no idea how constant the fights are.
Rev, you don't know that there are moments when I can't catch my breath. I can't catch a break. I'm going from one thing to another, facing one challenge after another. As soon as I can reconcile with one person, I fall out with somebody else. As soon as I get one child straightened out, the other child starts acting like they've lost their mind. I get mama stable and daddy gets sick. Get daddy stable, mama gets sick. Get my parents straight and my spouse gets sick. All I'm saying is Amos is suggesting that it could be because we are too gifted, too needed, too loved for God to let us sit in a place of complacency in Zion. And so I believe that the text just has a few things. It ain't much. I'm already more than halfway done. I believe to fight the disease of complacency, we have to avoid being figured out. We have to avoid defining ourselves as being chosen and allowing this particular label to help us to have a sense of entitlement. Israel wasn't entitled to this position as a super nation in the first place. They were then, therefore, not given positions, possessions, and place because of who they were. Systematic theology statement here. Israel was chosen for no other reason than God decided to choose them. Israel didn't do anything that made her worthy of being chosen. Israel didn't say anything that made her worthy of being, I'm hoping that I'm helping somebody. Israel was not a large enough company, nation possessing large weaponry. In fact, in Deuteronomy, God tells them, I chose you because you were one of the smallest of all the nations. You know why? Because then when I made you victorious, it proved to all of your enemies that it was your God who was keeping you and not you yourself. Hear me. This is my point today. You cannot be complacent and content. Be at ease. Wherever you are, whether it's Richmond or Henrico or Chesterfield or Hanover or where you work or somewhere outside of the Commonwealth, if you understand that there is nothing about God laying God's hand on you that had nothing to do with you, God laid God's hand on you because God decided to lay God's hand on you, and it was only motivated by God's own express will. Now, I know I just messed up some of you because you thought you were who you are because you all that. Because you smooth, smart, fine, cute, connected, rich. Because you connected with somebody politically. You better wake up and let somebody smack you back into reality. Everything that God has for you is because God wanted to do it for the kingdom. God blessed you because God is simply a blesser. God delivered you because God is a deliverer. If we could manipulate it, then we would corrupt it. And once we corrupt it, then we would lose it. Aren't you glad that you're being chosen, and your being chosen is not based on you or based on anybody else? If I had to rely on somebody else choosing what God has given to me, I wouldn't have much of what I have right now. But I thank God that nobody could block what God designed for me, because God decided that God wanted to choose me. I'm so glad that I'm chosen, and it doesn't make me arrogant. I don't think I'm better than anybody else. I'm not entitled to anything. I'm just grateful that God left me on the program. And I want to let you know that the God that we serve is in the blessing business, and you don't have to have the right degree or come from the right family. God chooses who God wants to choose to be who God wants you to be. And I'll start walking around now with the spirit of fear. I can't explain why God made me like this. I can't explain why God's blessed me like this. I don't know why God healed me like this. I don't know why God keeps on making a way. No, I don't even understand some things that are happening on my job or in my house. But my job is to live faithful
and thankful that God chose me. I'm trying to tell you today, don't you settle. Don't you be sitting on the sideline. Here's something else that I want to drop on you real quick. That sometimes it is in the difficult moments that God does God's best work. It is when things get tense, when moments are frustrating, when you can't see where you're trying to go, that God does God's best work. Follow me. Never try to eliminate the tension that exists between you being up on a pedestal and you being stuck in a season. Israel made a tragic mistake, and we've made it too. They were in a great spot. God had planted them in Zion. God had defeated and defended her against her adversaries. God gave her the power of her presence. The problem was Israel didn't know what to do with the pedestal they were on. They thought pedestals were a permanent fixture. They didn't realize that sometimes your elevation is not a permanent place. That God doesn't set us up for us to sit down. God takes us up to stretch us out. God gives us these high moments to show the potential from a higher vantage point. Their problem was they interpreted the pedestal as a permanent place of having arrived. Can I suggest to you this morning that there is a healthy tension that should always exist between where you are right now and understanding that seasons change? There are a lot of us who have gotten caught in being comfortable in the right now, and the season changed up on you. When you can understand that the tension, and you don't settle on the pedestal, you develop what is necessary for the next season. You grow closer to God, larger in your faith, more sensitive to other people. You prepare for what God has for you next. And when we become a person living in stagnation, you begin to blame everything around you for not staying in a season that you forget has to change. It's everybody else's fault. It's so unfair. It's unbelievable that things have turned out the way that they've turned out. Now, my question to you is this: why do you think it's unbelievable? What makes you so different than anybody else? For the rest of us, summer always turns to fall. Fall always turns to winter. Winter always becomes spring. Spring always becomes summer. Seasons have been changing since every last one of us have been born into creation. Now, here's the problem. The problem is when you slide into over self-confidence, you forget that seasons change for us too. So when they severed you off the job, when they found a loan, when something tragic happens, when you just so happen to live during a global pandemic, when you just so happen to live during a season of civil unrest, when it just so happens that because of COVID, your job shut down, when you lose a loved one, when your child gets a bad grade, when somebody gossips about you, when you bump your toe, when you start talking in crazy tones, I'm God's child, and why did this happen to me? I will tell you why, child of God. There is no place in the anointing where seasons are going to pass you by. Every last one of us will have to walk through every one of our seasons, and you ought to text somebody that. That's why you better be careful when you start talking about somebody who's going through a difficult time, because there might be a season where instead of it being them, it's you, and whatever rules you set when you're talking about them will be the rules you have to live by when it's your turn. Scripture says it rains on the just as well as the unjust. That's why I'm simply telling you today, you ought to be nice to as many people as possible. Help out as much as you can. Open doors for for as many as you can, because you're going up to a place, and every single human being has been there, a downward journey ahead of them, and it's cyclical, and it comes and it goes. But here is the celebration. Thank God that winter doesn't last always. Thank God that winter doesn't last always. Thank God that God gives us a break from having to fight Goliath. Thank God that God sends us to the brook after we prophesy to Ahab. Thank God that Jesus gets up from the grave. We get to enjoy the freshness of a Pentecost. And I'm telling you that every last one of us will go through some seasons. But I'm believing that you will emerge after the disaster. I'm believing that there is another job that will come after the one that you lost. I believe that God is going to help you to find some joy in your life after you lost a family member. Sometimes God shows up to move us and make us better than we were before we were agitated. There's a place between being elevated and caught in the season, and it's called tension. And you've got to learn how to respect it, learn how to nurture it. It's the place of moving in a complacent spirit. I'm headed on. I feed the season of complacency by always auditing my sense of thinking beyond myself, audit my outreach. This is what the Message translation says. It says, woe to you who are rushing headlong to disaster. Catastrophe is just around the corner. Woe to those who live in luxury and expect everyone else to serve them. Woe to those who live only for today, indifferent to the fate of others. Woe to the playboys and the playgirls who think life is a party held just for them. Woe to those addicted to feeling good, life without pain. Those obsessed with looking good, life without wrinkles. They could not care less about their country going to ruin. Woe to those who live only for today, indifferent to the fate of others. Their being at ease made them forget the very central nature of their being. What was that? They are God's people, and God has taught them to look out for each other. And the pedestal of arrogant self-perception that they are living with has infected them until others around them don't matter to them at all. The test of spiritual health was then as it is now. It is not where God has situated us alone, but who we are looking to share our situated station with. If you're thinking about how to include others in what God is doing for us, we are setting ourselves up to become imprisoned by our own success. The uneasiness God keeps wrapped around us makes us relational. You want to know why God keeps some of us struggling? Because struggling keeps us in relationship with other people. It makes us rush to other people. I need to talk to you, bruh. I need to talk to you. Why? Because God plants people in our lives to tell us that we're not crazy. Many of us are going through the same things, but here's the testimony. God brought me here. And the same God that brought me through is the same God who is going to bring you through. That's why God keeps us connected to us, each other. That's why we have brothers. That's why we have sisters. Because God doesn't want us to journey by ourselves. If you get upset when you're asked to give in this life at work, at home, in the community, at church, if you get mad because everywhere you go, life is demanding that you give something, God is trying to tell you, I'm trying to move you from being at ease and content and complacent in Zion, because if you don't, you're going to be destroyed by the very thing that I sent to bless your life. I promise you, God is giving you what God is giving you to get it to some others by delivering it through you. And if God can't trust you to give you what God can give others through you, God will stop giving to you, because God is not going to waste God's resources. I'm heading home. Don't let any place blur your vision for the people around you. In fact, some of us are so hooked up by God, and you know I'm talking to you. I'm convicting your spirit right now. that you should be known by rumor as a person who can and will hook somebody up. That God has been so good to some of us that we should be so good to other people that it shocks people how generous we are. And why do you do it? Because the more I give, the more God gives to me. The more I share, the more I care, the more I look out for others, the more God gives to me. Nicer, encouraging. You can keep your still water, but it will develop algae at some point. If the very thing God has sent you to bless others with, you keep to yourself. I want to encourage you today that you can't become complacent. That some of the tension that God sends it to move you. And that ultimately, at the end of the day, God deposits into you so that you won't be stuck in complacency, but that you become a vessel to be a blessing to somebody. The God we serve is so good to us, y'all, that we should not be able to help ourselves but to be good to somebody else. When's the last time you blessed somebody? I mean, seriously, with all them clothes in your closet? With all them shoes you got? With all that money you got? Your savings account full. What you doing with it? When last time you gave anything to anybody? God's saying, don't be sitting on the blessing. You got so much stuff, some of us, that you can't even do nothing with it. And you driving by, stepping over, walking by, working with folk who could be blessed. God gives you the overflow, which means to flow it over into somebody else's life. And I'm sitting on extra. I've got some extra peace. I got some extra joy. I'm just trying to help somebody at the end of the day. I know that you want to hear me shout, but I'm simply saying God's been good to you. So good that you shouldn't be able to help but to be good to somebody else. Jesus died too hard, blood spilled too much, body broken too much, head pierced too much. Gave everything that he had. And I'm telling you, in your life, if you look back at it, God's four enemies for you. Healed your body. Provided jobs for you. I know because I heard the testimonies. Opened up doors for you. Fed bellies. Made waves. Loved you. Cared for you. Provided for you. Protected you. God's been good to you. So my question is, when you gonna be good to somebody else? That's it. I got more, but it's been on my spirit to just stop right here. Because I know some of you you're bored at the house. You miss being in relationship with people. And I'm telling you that God is looking for some folk to step up and be a blessing, some way, some shape, some form. You want to fight the disease of complacency? You want to get out of just being stuck where you are? Then do something with the gifts that God has given you. Heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Dear God, we thank you. We love you. We appreciate you. You've spoken to our spirit and to our hearts, and we say thank you. Lessons that come from the book of Amos, the sixth chapter today, God, have challenged our hearts, challenged our spirits, challenged our minds. As I chew on this and wrestle with it, God, this is not one of those, this for my cousins and them sermons. This is a me looking at myself sermon. And there's so much going on in this world, God, now that I need to get up and do something. There's so many people right now, God, in this world who could just be blessed by me offering a piece of myself. That this is no time for me to be complacent. It's no time for me to be chilling. It's no time for me to be doing nothing. So help me. God, I pray right now for the person who doesn't know you. If there is somebody listening to your word who can be better by being in relationship with you, I challenge you right now to move in their spirit. This I pray in your name. Amen. Thank you, my brother and my sister, for listening to the word. If you're listening today and this word was for you, you don't have a relationship with God, you've not said, Lord, it's me. I want to be in relationship with you. It's me. I need to be saved. I don't have a church home. I'm just out here. If that's you today, we'd love to have you here at Six Mount Zion Baptist Church, right here in the historic Jackson Ward district of our city of Richmond. And if that is you and you want to be a part of our family, whatever platform you're watching on, just say, it's me. That's all you got to say, it's me. We'll know what you mean. It's me. Just type that in. You can send us a message or you can just type it in the chat and we'll get back to you whenever you're watching. We'll go back and look through the comments and make sure that we're not missing anybody. Now, if you don't want to be here, you're in another state, you're in another community, find a church home somewhere. If you don't know, then hit us up and we'll try to help you find one. Ultimately, we just want to make sure that you're saved. I hope the word blessed you today. The great thing about this virtual church thing is if you miss something, you can rewind it and go back and listen to it or share it. As I've been sharing with our members, if you're on social media, reshare, retweet, whatever it is that you need to do to help get the message out today. That is your evangelism task. Get the message of God out. I shared with you at the beginning of this moment of worship that you could give. We challenge you to go online and give on our website, www.smzbc.org. You can give on Cash App, $SMZBC. You can give on Venmo, SMZBC. Anytime you want to, you can always mail it to the church, 14 West Duval Street, or drop it off in a secure mailbox located on the outside of our building. What I want to share with you is this, our last reminder. We're going to continue to virtually worship, but for our members and friends who are here in the area, on July the 26th, we're going to take our first shot at doing a drive-in worship here at Six Mount Zion. We're going to be in the grass right out in front of the church. We're going to worship at 10 a.m. And so if you want to be a part of it, then why don't you go ahead and start to make some plans to be here on July 26th at 10 a.m. We're still going to worship online. Our online on that day won't start until 12 noon. 12 noon. All right, we're going to still worship online. All right, that's our word for today. That's our worship today. Those of you who are members and friends, I'm going to ask that you do me a favor as we sign off here. If you're watching on YouTube, I just need you to click the live button once we sign off here. And I've got a few things that I want to just share with you guys live in the moment this morning. All right. If you're on YouTube, go to the live. If you're on Facebook, just jump back onto the Facebook live video. And so you can get with us both ways. If you're on Uber conference call, just stay on. All right. Bless you guys. Thank you for being on with us. Join us next week. Same time, same place. Love you.